And the verse reads, Matthew chapter 22, verse, starting at that first verse. And Jesus spoke to them again in parables, saying, the kingdom of heaven is like a king who prepared a wedding banquet for his son. He sent his servants to those who had been invited to the banquet to tell them to come, but they refused to come. Then he sent some more servants and said, tell those who have been invited that I have prepared my dinner. My oxen and fatted cattle have been butchered, and everything is ready. Come to the wedding banquet. But they paid no attention and went off. One in his field, another in his business. The rest seized his servants, mistreated them, and killed them. The king was enraged. He sent his army and destroyed those murderers and burnt their city. Then he said to his servants, the wedding banquet is ready, but those I invited did not deserve to come. Go to the street corners and invite to the banquet anyone you find. So the servant went out into the streets and gathered all the people they could find, both good and bad, and the wedding hall was filled with guests. But when the king came in to see the guests, he noticed a man there who was not wearing his wedding clothes. Friend, he asked, how did you get here without wedding clothes? The man was speechless. Then the king told the attendants, tie his hands and foot and throw him outside into the darkness, where there will be weeping, gnashing of his teeth. For many have been invited, but few are chosen.
Amen.
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 Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we just want to thank you, Lord God. We ask of you, Lord God, to just allow us to meditate on what you have before us, Lord God. Let us delve into the word. Let us understand what is being given. Let myself be put in the background as your Holy Spirit brings forth your word. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
So, in the Old Testament, I shouldn't say old, in the olden times, when the Jewish people used to get married, what they would do would, the king or the one that was in charge of the wedding would give out garments, wedding garments. And this person who was invited, he didn't feel like wearing what was given to him. And in the scripture, it says that the king invited those that were good and bad. He didn't have any favoritism. Those that were good and bad. Amen?
Amen.
But there's this particular one that felt like wearing work boots. There's this particular one that felt like wearing his jeans to this wedding. In other words, I'm just going to come to this wedding
the way I want.
You just gonna have to deal with it. But the problem with that is that he didn't think that there would be any consequences. He didn't think there was going to be any repercussions. So when people in general come to God, they have this audacity to say, oh, God said they could come as you are. But they misrepresent the scripture that they say, there's no word in the Bible that says come as you are. Nowhere in the Bible that says that. Not to say that God doesn't take you as you are, but it doesn't say come as you are. Because what happens is, when we look at what other people say when it comes to scripture, and we try to fit it to our own
nothing,
and we try to fit it in our own way, in our own merit, things get out of hand. Things don't work out as well. Amen?
Amen.
So this man, at this wedding, he has his own self-righteousness on. He has pride on. He has egotism on. He has his own arrogance on. So when it's time for him to, when everybody's looking at him, they throw him out. The king himself throws him out. And it's not that God doesn't want you the way you are. It's the point of you have to empty yourself. You have to be committed to say, I had enough of the way I was living, I had enough of the way I was doing things, I just had enough. And in order for you to even understand or to come to God, you have to give up everything that you've already been trained to do, that the world has trained you to do. And we, as people, we think that God, how should I say it? Well, God knows my heart. God, I can get it, because God knows my heart. I'll come when I'm perfect, when I'm good and ready. But how many people go to the hospital with a good bill of health? Nobody goes to the hospital with a good bill of health. When you go to the hospital, I'm not talking about the doctors, I'm talking about the hospital. Usually, 100% out of 100 times, something's wrong. You're already sick, and you want emergency help right then and there. Nobody goes to the hospital and feel like wasting time saying and having the doctor say, what's wrong? Well, I just feel like talking to somebody. I feel good. Nobody does that. So if you think that you're going to be perfect before God and think that you're going to be ready, or I'm going to get myself ready, you're just wasting time, wasting breath, because what you're saying is that I don't need God. When I'm ready, good and ready, that's when I'll talk to God. That's when I'm good and ready to have a conversation and let God know how I'm feeling. But it don't work that way.
No, don't.
It does not work that way. So as you can see in the scripture, when it says that the so-called scripture, where it says come as you are, obviously you can't come as you are. Because if you came as you are, then we'll have some problems. You can come to Christ and let Jesus know all the issues that you have. But don't think that when you're ready to do that, those issues have to be changed. You can't think that you're going to just say, you're going to have to accept me as I am and deal with it. Because God doesn't work that way. God does not work that way. Amen?
Amen.
What happens is in Isaiah verse 1, chapter 1, verse 18, it says, come now and let us reason together, and says the Lord. Though your sins been as scarlet, they shall be as white as snow, and though they are red like crimson, they shall be as wool. That scripture right there gets screwed up all the time. But people think that we can get God compromises instead of justified. So in other words, as if I say, I'm coming as I am, but I'm keeping all the baggage with me, that's only compromise. You're allowing God to compromise with your lifestyle. And if that be the case, then what's the point of Jesus dying on the cross?
True.
That's where the justification is. If it wasn't for the cross, there would be no reasoning. Because God doesn't reason with sin. God looks at sin, and he looks at the cross, and then he justifies it.
Amen.
Because without the cross, there is no reason.
True.
So what I'm going to do is to explain where I'm coming from, where people say, God knows my heart. I'm going to try to explain this to you. Amen?
Amen.
So I'm going to call Deacon Anthony.
Sit down.
Oh, you're doing the drive. You're going to take me around. Mm-hmm. Move that chair.
We got the radio.
So here I am playing Christ, and I'm getting into Deacon Anthony's business. What I'm going to do is, I want Deacon Anthony. There's no radio. We don't need no radio because we're concentrating. So, I want Deacon Anthony to take me around his neighborhood. What I mean by his neighborhood, I'm talking about his house, because God knows my heart. Amen?
Amen.
So, we're going to the right atrium, and he is going to take me into the neighborhood, show me around, and one of the things is about his family.
My family?
Your family.
They're good, man.
Your family's
okay.
Good.
Yeah, okay. I got one sister's going to do something, but
well, here's the thing. Are you praying for your sister?
Yeah, I'm praying for her.
You're praying for her? That's the only sister you're praying for? What about the other sister?
I'm praying for all of them.
Take me to the left atrium.
Oh, it's on the left.
your family, and not so much as your family, but your friends.
No, like I said, family's okay. You know, they're dealing with stuff, but I leave my boss in here. Family and friends, I only got a few friends, but, you know, I put them before the Lord. They all got their own situations they're going through, and you know, if I can help, I help them, you know. That's what friends do.
Okay.
They're cool.
Let's go to the right ventricle, and let's talk about your co-workers and,
We get along for the most part. You know, I get them in prayer too. Mm-hmm. Might be one or two I bump into them, you know. Some people it's hard to deal with, but you know, I put it before the Lord.
Every single one.
Okay. Even the difficult ones, you know.
Okay.
I used to be, but now I'm not like that anymore. So.
Okay. Well, let's go to the left ventricle and let's delve into that. What's on the left? You don't know what's on the left? Let's talk about Tyrone. Let's talk about Tyrone.
Tyrone owes me money. You know, I try to deal with Tyrone.
Is that why he's not in church?
Probably why, though. We see each other.
Okay. And you're the deacon in church, right?
True.
Okay. So, Tyrone owes you money.
Yeah.
And you ain't talked to him in a while.
Obviously,
he's not here. So, we have issues.
Yeah,
we
got issues,
yeah. Okay. What's going on with
him?
You didn't think I was
going to
bring any of this up?
She didn't be wrong. We're not together anymore.
Well, I haven't heard anything you bringing up, Cindy, since the time that situation happened. And here we are. At the fourth chamber of your heart. This is your heart. Now you promised me that you were gonna give me all your heart. Not a quarter, not three quarters, not a half, all of it. So now you got an issue with Cindy, and I ain't heard two peeps about her. And she has your kids, right?
Yeah.
Okay, so well, what's going on with that?
The kids are good, but I'm her. I don't deal with her. So.
Okay. And what about Leroy?
That's a problem with me, man. I got a problem with you. Uh-oh.
Okay, so this is what bothers me, is that your family's good, your friends are good, your co-workers are good, but you have people in your life that you can't deal with, that are obviously avoiding me to be in that side of town.
I didn't think of it that way, but you know.
Well, this is the problem. This it becomes the problem. So how do you expect me to give you 100% if you can't give 100%? Because it's just as much as you may not like Leroy, that's how much I love Leroy. And Tyrone, and Cindy. And I didn't even bring up the guy that had a smell to him. I didn't even go down that road. So when you say to me, God knows my heart, you're absolutely right. You are absolutely right.
Amen.
But it takes you to do something about it because I can't.
Amen.
I can't
pray for you. Amen.
And now you have all this responsibility, and I expect you to act a certain way so you can uphold the responsibility that I've given you. Because if you can't love one person, what makes you think that you're responsible for loving the other person? That's easy to love because they're loving you back. Okay, so pop this car because you got something to think about.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen.